Hey everyone, my name is Lauren. I'm the volunteer and education coordinator with the Green Mountain Club. It's great to have you all here tonight. If you're just getting here, we'd love for you to share with us in the chat box where you're coming from. It's really fun to see how far away people can come from to join these Zoom webinars. You're joining us tonight as the last show of the GMC's 30th annual James P. Taylor Speaker Series. This speaker series is named after James Taylor, founder of the Long Trail, who had this idea to create the Long Trail back in 1910. While many of you may know what the GMC is all about, I'll take a quick minute or two to tell you what we do here. There we go. GMC was founded in 1910, like I said, to care for the Long Trail. From 1910 to roughly 1930, we built this trail from the Mass border all the way up to Canada. Since then, we've been, I like to say, fixing all the problems that we made then, but in a good way, I'm saying, making it better, making it more accessible, all that kind of stuff. Today, we take care of the Long Trail, all the side trails to the Long Trail, the Appalachian Trail in Vermont, where it starts in Massachusetts, goes to Killington, and then goes east to Hanover, and also about 50 miles of hiking trails up in the Northeast Kingdom. If you've been up Mount Mansfield, or if you've been up Camel Sump in the state of Vermont, or if you live in Burlington and go out on the lake like Jordan did this past summer, and if you can see that Green Mountain ridgeline, the Green Mountain Club and our agency partners and all the people that have been a part of it are kind of part of what's conserved that and kept that accessible and open for people to go to the top of those mountains on foot. So really have a big network of volunteers and seasonal staff and full-time year-round staff that keep that all going. They care for backcountry campsites, privies, the fragile alpine summits, the ponds, all kinds of stuff there so that the ecology of the Long Trail and the benefits of going out there can all be felt by people. GMC does a lot more than that. We don't have a lot of time here. If you want to learn more, become a member of the GMC, follow us on the social medias, and keep on attending events like this. Mostly get out, go hiking, enjoy all the benefits that Vermont has and getting into the mountains. If you want to learn more about going hiking, our visitor center staff are available from the visitor center here in Waterbury Center. You can call them 5 days a week and they'll give hiking advice on where you can go. And like I said, membership is one of the best ways to support the GMC, to learn what's going on out there. And you can find how to be a member really easily on GMC's website. I'll also put some of those posts in the chat box when I get finished here. I'd like to thank our sponsor for the night, Concept 2. You can see their logo down there. Concept 2 is manufacturers of the world's best-selling rowing machine and oars that are used by the world's best rowers. Concept 2 is based out of Morrisville, Vermont. It's been headquartered in Vermont for 45 years, ever since its founding. And so Morrisville is just down the road from the GMC and from the Long Trail itself. Concept 2 has been a great supporter of the GMC for many years, and they're all about the growth of rowing indoors and outdoors and believing that rowing is a lifelong activity accessible to all. I'd like to thank Concept 2 for their support in their past years, this year, and hopefully many years into the future. I also think that Concept 2 is a very fitting sponsor for tonight's paddling talk that Jordan's going to be giving. Last thing I'll do is go over just a little bit of Zoom technology. I know it's the, third year of their pandemic and you all know this, but we're gonna in Zoom webinar right now. There's a couple different features that we'll use for the night. There's a chat feature, which you all have been able to use to share where you're joining from. Thanks for doing that. If you haven't yet, let us know what town or organization you're coming in from. There's the raise hand feature. If you're having a tech issue, something's not working out, raise your hand and I'll send you a message to the chat. We can figure that out. There's the Q&A. If you have a specific question for Jordan and Duane, put that question in the Q&A. That'll come in. We'll keep it in a queue. And then when we have a Q&A period at the end, we'll go through those and we'll get those answered. So if you have something to say, if there's a comment, use the chat box. If you have a specific question, the best way for us to keep track of that is in the Q&A. Last thing I'll say is we're going to do a couple polls tonight to get to know everybody out in the audience and for Jordan and Duane to kind of tailor their presentation a little bit. So you'll see a poll pop up at some point. We'd like you to answer the questions that go in there. We'll share out the results. It's a really fun way to feel like we're kind of a crowd, even though you're all in your own bedrooms or couches or wherever you are. That's the Zoom tech. That's the GMC. That's our sponsor. Now it is my immense honor to welcome Jordan Rowell and Duane Peterson to give this presentation tonight. I've known Jordan for, my gosh, almost 5 years at this point. I think that's a good thing, I'd say. I consider Jordan a great friend. We spent a lot of time together, and I'm really excited to see this presentation. Jordan has a great knack for coming up with weird, wacky ideas that are really, really cool. And it's always fun to go for a brainstorming walk with him and hear what's up next and what his next adventure is. So seeing this film, seeing pieces of this film, hearing about the story, and then getting to get kind of a glimpse of Duane's expertise in this and get a preview of what will be to come in April, I'm really excited for. Jordan's also a former Green Mountain Club staff member. He's a current Green Mountain Club volunteer and has nice ties to Vermont's conservation and trail work industry. So it's really a pleasure to have him here. And with that, I'll stop sharing and I'll hand it over to you. Let's see. Bear with us,
everyone. Thank you, Lauren.
You're welcome.
And thanks to everybody for joining us tonight. This is super exciting to be showing just the second group of people ever to see any clips of this film. So it's awesome to be here. And I'm having a fun little thing with...
Just refresh it.
I promise you, everyone, we practiced this many times. Zoom will never fail to baffle at times.
There we go. Awesome. Yeah, thanks everyone for coming out. My name is Jordan Rowell. I'm currently a student at the University of Vermont studying natural resources.
And my name is Duane Peterson. I'm a local filmmaker. I work as a video editor and as the programmer of the Climate Action Film Festival. And I also live here in Burlington, Vermont.
So we just wanted to start off our presentation tonight with a quick land acknowledgement. The land that this project took place in the Lake Champlain Basin is on the unceded lands of the Mohawk and the Abenaki and the Mohican people. And we just want to acknowledge that. The photo on the left is me next to Odzi Hozo, who is the creator of Lake Champlain, according to the Abenaki origin story of the lake.
And we're here tonight to present about our upcoming documentary film, our short film. It's going to be about 40 minutes long. This is the poster for it on the left. And I just like to quickly, this is going to be the only part of the presentation that is read tonight, but I wanted to read you the synopsis. It says, motivated by a desire to better understand his home watershed, Jordan Rowell here embarks on a two-week kayaking trip along the 120-mile length of Lake Champlain, stopping along the way to talk to a wide range of characters about the future of their shared basin. Set 50 years after the passage of the Clean Water Act, no other lake is both a celebration of the unique beauty of Lake Champlain and a confrontation with its greatest challenges. This adventure conservation documentary strives to inspire people to better connect with the natural world around them, see issues from a different point of view, and get involved with stewardship efforts happening close to home. So that's just kind of a big picture, you know, what this film is and what we're here to present about.
And we figured instead of talking to you too much about the film, we would just give you a chance to see some of it. So here's the opening clip of our forthcoming film, No Other Lake. Okay, Lauren, how about you throw up the first round of poll questions for us? Oh, wow, quick, awesome. So yeah, we just want to get an idea of how familiar people are with the lake. You know, at this point, we're very familiar. We go there a fair amount, I'd say. It won't let me submit. Hopefully it lets you submit. So take a minute to fill out those questions. I think a lot of folks in this room, I take it, are pretty familiar with the mountains of Vermont. You know, since the Green Mountain Club's mission is to make the Vermont mountains play a larger part in the lives of the people, after all. But I know for me, that the lake didn't really play as large of a role in my life growing up as the mountains did. And so I guess I'm wondering if other people have had that similar experience. Do we get the results quickly, Lauren, or do we just...
Yeah, we got 75% answered. Everybody finish off. People are still putting a little bit in, but I think that's a pretty good grasp of the audience. So I'll end this, Jordan, and we can share the results. How's that sound?
Yeah, great. Okay, so yeah, most of folks are somewhat familiar with the lake. A little bit more split on if we spend much time. We got once in a while, a fair amount. Okay. But overwhelmingly, people want to get to know Lake Champlain better. Awesome.
Love to see that. That's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we share your sentiment. You know, you might ask why we started the presentation showing you the last clip that we did, you know, showing you one of the problems. The clip you just saw is of a cyanobacteria bloom, one of the biggest that people in the Missisquoi Bay region have seen, according to the folks we ran into while we were there. And I'm not going to get too into the details of cyanobacteria, but the basics are that it's something that happens to lake when there's too many nutrients coming in to the water, mostly phosphorus, and mixing with water that's usually warmer, when sediments get stirred up from storms, and that phosphorus is coming into the lake from places such as stormwater, from urban areas, from wastewater treatment plants, and a lot from agriculture as well. And so Missisquoi Bay has all of those things. I also want to say that, you know, paddling through blooms is not something that is recommended. You can't tell when they're toxic necessarily, but there are blooms that can be toxic. And so it's not something we take lightly to show you that clip or to really paddle through it in the adventure. But I hope as we sort of like explain through our presentation, what we were after is to sort of tell the story of what's happening to this place. And we felt like the only way to do that was to really confront the problems head on like we did. So Duane and I are both from, you know, 5-7 miles away from Lake Champlain. We grew up in Essex, and this is the Burlington waterfront on the left, as I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. And for me, that's like where my perspective of Lake Champlain started and persisted for most of my life. You know, my grandmother would take me down to the dock down and get French fries at the restaurant down there. And I was sort of, my perspective of lake was always limited to that. You know, you see the Adirondacks in the background. I didn't really have much of a concept of the environmental problems that were facing the lake. And I also didn't really know much about the expanse of the lake that stretched to the north or to the south. Duane and I met in high school and became good friends. And we both sort of left Vermont after that point, and sort of started to both get interested in different environmental issues, me through working outside and Duane really getting full on into the into film studies. And at that time, I think Lake Champlain even took a more distant role in our lives. But when it would come up, it was this idea that when you're out west, the conversation of water usually resolves around the lack thereof. And so I know we both would sort of share with people like this idyllic vision of Vermont and the Lake Champlain Basin, and like the people there know how to treat their natural resources, right? We both ended up back in Vermont around 2020 for different reasons. And my reason was, as the picture on the right shows, that I came back to school to start studying natural resources at UVM. And it was there that the first class I took was all about like establishing a sense of place and learning about the environment that, you know, that the students were going to be living in for the next 4 years. And even though I'd grown up here, I realized quickly that I didn't know anything about the lake, and I became really fascinated with it. As I'm sure a lot of you can share, you know, when you start to learn about a place, a lot of us want to like throw on a backpack and like go on a hike and go explore. And I had that same feeling with the lake. As I started to, we had guest speakers come into the class and teach us about the lake from different perspectives. I really appreciated that. I learned a lot, but I knew that there was sort of a wall for me where I just had to go out and start experiencing it. And so I came up with this scheme that was, you know, inspired in part by the experiences I'd had on the Long Trail, which I hiked in 2014. And I knew that it was possible to like do these through adventures, these through hikes or through paddles, and go the length of a place and, you know, experience it along the way and make stops. And, you know, I remember texting Duane while I was in class, because we sort of hadn't hung out for a long time. We were both back in Vermont. And I said, you know, you want to paddle the length of Lake Champlain with me. And that's sort of where it all started. So you'll be familiar with the image on the right. This is the Long Trail tracing the length of Vermont and the spine of the Green Mountains. On the left is the route that I wanted to take to paddle the length of Lake Champlain. It's about 120 miles from Whitehall, New York, up to Venise and Quebec in Canada. And I was going to give myself 2 weeks to do it to make sure I had enough time to really immerse myself in the place and not just, you know, paddle it as fast as I could. I really wanted to experience it and learn about it. And so I knew I needed some gear. I have never been a kayaker. You know, I do have hiking experience. I love to be outside. I do have a little bit of a water phobia though. So kayaking is not something I've spent much time doing. So, you know, first had the idea in fall of 2020 and immediately got to work trying to buy a kayak and get the right gear. Early on, I found the Lake Champlain Paddlers Trail, which its whole mission is to establish campsites, much like the Green Mountain Club does for the Long Trail, establish campsites along the way so you have a place to stop and rest during your adventure. And I also found this guidebook written by these two women who've paddled the entire shoreline of the lake, which was a huge resource to learn like where to stop to get food and where are the good put-ins and where are, you know, good wildlife viewing areas. And yeah, the whole idea was to through paddle it. I was going to camp on the lake. I wasn't going to, you know, go back home every night and get back in the car. You know, I was going to like start out and commit myself and for 2 weeks just live on the lake. And that meant I needed to fit everything I was going to need for those 2 weeks into my kayak. So this is probably a familiar image for some of you who've packed for, you know, vacations or long backpacking trips or ski trips before, where you lay all your gear out in a row and, you know, count everything. And, you know, luckily in a boat, I could travel a little bit heavier. So I wasn't really weighing grams or anything. But yeah, this was really starting to plan for the trip and get my gear in order. And part of the thing I knew about Lake Champlain early on was that people would tell me that it can get sketchy out there. When I would tell people that I never kayaked before and I was going to paddle the length of the lake, they would sort of look at me and nod and just give me this skeptical look like, yeah, okay. You know that people have, you know, died in their boats out there, right? And it's true. The weather can change fast on Lake Champlain, as this picture shows, of a storm sneaking up on me in Button Bay. And so I started to get the feeling that I should probably find some mentors. And so I linked up with the Lake Champlain Kayakers Club, which was an awesome resource for someone who didn't know anything about paddling. There was a group of like a dozen people that went out on adventures regularly. And so all through last summer, early summer, May, June, July, I was trying to go out with them as much as possible. And they sort of took me under their wing, mostly because I think they didn't want to see me get hurt. And they were like, oh, we got to look out for this kid. And so once I'd done all the preparations, or at least as much as I thought for this trip, you know, you get the question of like, well, where do you start? You know, do you start at north? Do you start in the south? Like, I don't know. And so like any good, you know, Vermont Green Mountain Club member, I started on the Long Trail, started on top of Mount Mansfield. This is me and Bill McKibben hiking up to the tallest point in Vermont and one of the high points of the Lake Champlain Basin. And it was here that about a couple months before my trip that Bill sort of helped me lay out this bird's eye view of the basin and get an idea of, you know, what this trip was in sort of the grander scheme of humans trying to come to grips with their environment and learn better our place in the world, but also just get an idea of, like, you know, the immensity of the watershed. And finally, I put my boat in the water. And this is send-off day, the launch, where I was joined with some family and friends down in Whitehall, New York. And after talking about it long enough, finally started paddling. The adventure on Lake Champlain is one that I'd recommend to anybody, especially those who are interested in long adventures. Like if you've hiked the long trail, this might be a good next step. It changes character quite a bit from the narrows of Dresden, where you could nearly throw a rock across, to places like the Crown Point Bridge, where you're opened up into this, you know, you're going through this gateway into the main part of the lake, where you can see the Adirondacks on one side and the Green Mountains on the other. It's really a unique experience. And of course, if you spend enough time on Lake Champlain, you'll be graced with beautiful sunsets. And I got to experience many. And so I'd like to share with you the next clip from our film, which is just north of the Crown Point Bridge, showing you, you know, one of my favorite parts of the lake that I experienced on the trip. So for those of you who, like me, may have only seen the lake from one perspective and hadn't seen some of those places before, although we've tried our best, you know, to capture these images and show you them. I don't know. I hope you'll consider getting out there and seeing it for yourself, because the Palisades at Split Rock is truly an amazing sight. I guess it's at this point in the presentation that we remind you and ourselves a little bit that having this fun adventure and, like, you know, immersing ourselves in, like, the spirit of this place and just, like, getting to know it and learning about it wasn't the only goal of this project. We thought that there was an opportunity for people beyond the classrooms at UVM or, you know, beyond our circles to learn more about the lake and what was going on. And we thought there was a unique way to tell that story that hadn't been told yet. And that's how that second text to Duane that followed said, and after we paddle and while paddling the lake, do you want to make a movie about it?
Right, right. And so, yeah, I will talk a little bit about the making of the film. We really kind of wanted to, I think, tell the story of the Lake Champlain Basin, and not necessarily the story of its history, but really the story of its future and of where we might be going in this place together. And like Jordan talked about in the beginning, this film was inspired by a class, which I think is one fantastic way to tell a story or to deliver information. A book would be another way. I'm a filmmaker, so this is kind of the way that that I can tell stories and the way that we chose to partner to tell this story. So along the way, we interviewed about a dozen people, or Jordan rather interviewed about a dozen people with an extraordinarily wide range of backgrounds. Here we are with the chief of the Nalhegan band of the Cusack Abenaki Nation, Don Stevens, early on in the trip. Here we are with Trevian Stanger, St. Michael's professor at the mouth of the Winooski River. So along the way, we engaged not just the lake itself, but really the people who call it home and who have been really thinking a lot about what it means to live here and what it means to be creating a better future for this place. Here's Jordan and a UICC worker pulling invasive species on very second day of the trip. This was an interview that was actually not planned. A lot of work went into finding people who might want to talk on camera and tell their side of the story or their side of Lake Champlain. Some of our shoots, though, were spontaneous, and this was one of them. We rolled up on these people pulling invasive species and joined them and shot a wonderful scene learning about that important work.
The Demery and Helen, who we ran into here pulling invasives, really a cool example of what it looks like to steward a place. And you know, I think Demery, it was her second summer doing this work, and much like the Green Mountain Club, the Vermont Youth Conservation Corps is one of those consistent stewards of these landscapes. And it was really cool to not just like talk to them on the shores of the lake, but to you know, show up and say, hey, can we try and join them and get to experience that. It was cool.
In order to be, you know, flexible and available to do this kind of shoot, I needed to really be on the water to be with Jordan. So here I am on the right with our filmmaking partner, Ryan Malley, who did all the beautiful drone work that you saw earlier, and who's a second camera operator as well. Shooting Jordan, I think this is on the very first day as well. So the boat, this was like, I think a 12-foot dinghy with a little 4-horsepower motor on it, just enough to kind of keep up with Jordan and follow him on his journey. Really kind of allowed us to be on the water, you know, kind of with him immersed in the lake, just as he was. We had considered different ways to shoot it, but this being with him along the way was kind of invaluable in terms of really immersing ourselves in his story. Here's the reverse thing. We had a GoPro on his boat oftentimes. So that's what he would see while we were filming, making this film. I think with that, we have another clip to show, another short clip. This is a short interview, one that would not have been possible without actually being on the water with Jordan.
So that clip with Andrew, before we move forward, Lauren, do we have another poll?
Popping up right now, everyone, thanks for your wonderful participation in the first one. We have some more questions to get to know you. So you should see that popping up on your screens. Please let us know. Let us know your experiences here.
And Lauren, I'll let you throw us the results once you think you have a quorum.
That sounds good, Jordan. We are still getting people sending in right now. So
great.
We can observe your beautiful truck at the moment.
Running into Andrew on this trip was really serendipitous. He actually called me when I was about halfway through the paddle because I think I'd been, you know, tagging UVM stuff on Instagram and participating in the UVM Poco Club. He, you know, gave me a call and said, hey, I'm a huge kayaker. Like, I'd love to meet up with you. And, I thinking about this picture, it just felt like we were like this, you know, filming caravan on our trip on Lake Champlain, where we had all the gear. And, you know, like Duane said, we planned a lot of these interviews, but a lot of them we just had to sort of be ready for. And so I think how it worked is Andrew called me and said, hey, I'm available tomorrow or whatever, like, let's meet up. And so I had immediately called Duane and be like, I think it was his rest day or whatever, and say, hey, I know you're supposed to have the day off tomorrow, but you got to drive down to the sandbar. Or to Missisquoi Bay. We're going to meet up with Andrew. So it was fun how it all worked out like that.
Jordan, we got a good number of answers here. So I'm going to end this and we'll share out the results.
Yeah. Awesome.
Beautiful.
Okay, in terms of stewardship, seems like, as I'd expect with the Green Mountain Club crowd, some folks have participated in stewardship efforts, and that might even be a trick question. As we'll talk about in a little bit, I know I learned that stewardship efforts happening on land, you might often not think of trail work as having anything to do with water quality, but it does. The Lake Champlain Basin is big. So that's cool. And having a group of people to explore with, that seems to be the winner there. That's awesome. Hopefully we can all paddle together sometime. And are you following us on Instagram? No. All right. Well, we can change that. We were asked recently if we had a mailing list, which we don't. So Instagram is sort of our mailing list. So if you want to stay tuned with any future updates, which we'll mention later, you probably want to get on that. But in terms of, you know, how we made this happen, yeah, this is the fleet.
Yeah.
my kayak on top. I think this was the first day going out, right? Yeah.
Most of our pictures, apparently, once we were underway, we were mostly making the film and not taking pictures, I guess. But all of our pictures are from the first day. Yes, this is, yep, and right here in Burlington, setting off. Oh, yeah. Here I am standing in the dinghy with a GoPro on the end of a painter's pole, a technique that I was trying to use, really just trying to pull out every trick in the book, every tool in my toolbox to try to tell this story in kind of an unconventional way, or at least in a way that kind of broke the mold of the ways that these kinds of stories have been told in the past. Really trying to tap into the adventure aspect of this adventure conservation documentary idea that we're working with. So this is me trying to get up close and personal with Jordan there.
Yeah, I think the next section of photos, we just want to show you a few of the behind the scenes shots,
right.
And talk about some of the process of you know, what it actually looked like to put a lot of these clips together.
Right. So here is again the dinghy pulled out just north of the Palisades, the big cliffs there in Split Rock in New York that we saw a clip of earlier. This is where we pulled off to fly that drone for that footage that you saw.
And the thing that you might not know about drones is that if it's raining at all, or if it's very windy, they really don't like to be in the air.
Right.
In fact, the drone operator really doesn't like them to be right. in the air. And so this shot, actually, in order to get those split rod shots, I actually had to paddle there twice because right. the first time we went out there, it was raining and windy. And we had to turn around and go back to camp and wait out the storm and try it again. And lucky enough, we had this small boat that we could pull up on the rocky shore and right. didn't have some, you know, big motor boat.
Oh, here's just a shot of myself there on the left and our good friend Ryan Malley, again, the drone pilot, second shooter. This is, I think, back in May, the very first shoot of the whole film when we hiked up Mount Mansfield with Bill McKibben. And that was, I think, one of the hardest production days I can imagine, or in recent memory anyway. I don't know if any of you have spent much time outside with Bill, but he... he's in better shape than I am. Let's just say that. And he charged up that mountain. And I think we did Mansfield in like 70 minutes or something ridiculous with these cameras. I'm trying to shoot along the way and kind of leapfrog him. That was a strenuous day.
That was a moment that we said, oh, this is what we're getting into.
Right, right.
Or at least you. I was just chatting with Bill.
Here's a shot that, so again, just trying to get every angle we could get, we could imagine. I think we actually saw some clips that we captured from underwater, but this is, my kind of point of view, actually getting in the water. I think you can't really tell the whole story of Lake Champlain from above the surface of the water. I felt pretty strongly about that. So we used some underwater cameras and all different kinds of tools to, again, really try to see this from as many different angles as possible. Right, so this is my kind of view from my captain's seat for most of this, or, you know, for 2 weeks in the summer, basically every day out on the water with Jordan.
Because this was one of our training sessions,
oh, I that's think, right.
before
yeah.
the trip, because right. I had never kayaked before.
Right, and I had never actually operated a motorboat before. I had to get a boating license for this. So it was a learning experience for both of us. We were definitely both learning a lot about the lake and about what it took to... pull this off.
And this was one of our early iterations of a perspective. You'll notice a something like a selfie stick on the stern of my boat. That was a perspective that I'm not sure came through in the didn't make the final cut, but another example of just trying to get every angle. And I think that it, you know, me being a bit new to this filmmaking process too, and really, you know, seeing what it takes to like tell the story well, is that we couldn't film from the shore for the whole movie, right? we wanted to give this perspective that people who were watching the film were sort of there in the places with us. And so that's like the big reason why we put such an emphasis on being on the water, because, you know, we wanted people who maybe didn't live near Lake Champlain or didn't have the opportunity to get out on the lake to at least be able to partake in that adventure in a way.
Another behind the scenes one. The boat was, this is a very old, I think this boat is about as old as I am. I don't know, do you have a story about this one? This is just me pumping out some water. It was a great boat. It worked very well for us, but did take on a little bit of water. Is there more to this story?
Well, I'm basking in the sun and Duane's pumping the water out of the boat. So, we'll leave it at that.
Yep. And so this is our core film crew, me on the left, Jordan in the center, and Ryan on the right. This is at the very top of Split Rock Mountain on the New York side, just above the cliffs that you saw in that earlier clip. This was another big hiking day. I think we hiked 8 miles or something with our gear this day. And again, I think it was, you know, really important to see this place from a lot of different perspectives, both in terms of the people that we talked to, but also the places that we went. And that meant getting on land and getting up high as well. So this is,
Yeah, something that's really interesting about the Lake Champlain Basin is the amount of land that drains into the lake is a really high proportion to the surface area of water that there is. It's a greater proportion than even that of the Great Lakes. And so you have any agricultural, activity, urbanization, anything happening within the bounds of the basin impacts water quality. And so that was like a big part of the conversation here was, even though you can see the lake from here, we're also looking into an agricultural area and developments on the other side of the ridge and thinking about, you know, how that activity on land impacts water. And I think the other fun fact from this one is, I think this is the outlet of the Otter Creek back here. And that's where Duane and Ryan started their morning.
Right. Yeah, this picture was probably taken early afternoon. We started around sunrise in the dinghy and boated across the lake from Ferrisburg, you know, the mouth of the Otter Creek, which I think is actually this point right here. But anyway, across crossing about 2.5 or 3 miles of open water with all of our gear loaded down for 2 nights of camping. That was an adventure on its own.
Yeah, crossing the broad lake there in a little boat is a harrowing adventure in its own right. So I guess, you know, the question is, why do this? If you're familiar with the work going on around Lake Champlain, whether that's through the Lake Champlain Basin Program, the Lake Champlain Committee, one of the dozens of small community nonprofits, the Friends of Northern Lake Champlain, whether it's the water quality team at the Vermont Youth Conservation Corps. I mean, I can go on a really long time. The Farmers Watershed Alliance. There's a lot of work going on to improve the human impact on the lake. And it's been going on since it started to show signs of going downhill, in the 70s. And that's why the Clean Water Act was passed. And so there's like a part of me that can anticipate someone asking, you know, well, why do we need another movie or, you know, a media project about it? And our answer to that is that while a lot of the conversations we have with people are identifying problems that aren't necessarily novel, that have been talked about before, there has been scientific research done on cyanobacteria, on invasive species, on habitat loss. But we thought there was an opportunity to sort of transmit that information in a new way. A big goal of ours was that was to not have young people have the same experience we did, you know, getting to be in our mid to late 20s and realizing that we didn't know much about this lake we'd grown up alongside. And so our target audience for this film is really, a lot of people, but we want to get this film in front of young people in schools and help them make the connection between the academic side of things, from the science classes that might be taken, the biology classes, learning about natural resources and clean water, and being able to like connect that to something tangible, something close to home, and to, you know, in adventure.
Right. Yeah, I would say that there are many good films about Lake Champlain and about, you know, all places all over the world that are, you know, science-based, and they interview all kinds of experts and make compelling arguments. We kind of wanted to build on that tradition of filmmaking and introduce kind of and combine it with adventure film, right? And bring kind of bring this story to life through an adventure, or kind of use the adventure as the hook to kind of tell a bigger story, or a story that's greater than just, you know, the story of one guy on a trip. But it's really through that we're trying to tell trying to tell this story and make this film.
So there's three main goals of the project. We want to inspire people to spend more time on Lake Champlain. That's why we were kind of gauging your experience on the lake. It's a beautiful place. I spent a lot of time on it. We did. And I didn't see a lot of other human-powered travelers. And it'd be awesome to see more. The second thing is that we want to challenge people to see things from new perspectives. I think it's really easy for us to, you know, sort of keep our heads down and focus on our lived experiences and forget that, you know, the other people around the basin who might do something different for a living, who might have a different experience on the lake, you know, it's easy to discredit that because, you know, we haven't lived it too. But I think the more we can listen to each other, the better we'll be able to solve these problems together. And the third goal is to challenge people also to participate in stewardship efforts at a lake. It can be really overwhelming when we're talking about, you know, clean water and in an era of climate change, like how to get involved. But as we hope to show in the film, there are a lot of ways that one person can have an impact, even if it's something as simple as planting a seedling and building a new wetland like we did in the film. So just a big shout out to all of our sponsors who helped make this project happen. You know, first and foremost, I know Molly Varner is in the crowd with the Vermont Association of Conservation Districts, Grand Isle County Natural Resource Conservation District, our fiscal sponsor for the project. Could not have done this without you all, and really gave us a good perspective on what was happening in their part of the lake. The Lake Champlain Basin Program, the University of Vermont, and the John M. Bissell Foundation also supported us on this project. And Warner Paddles and NRS also helped us out with some gear.
So that's it. That's basically our presentation. Again, our film is called No Other Lake. It'll be about 40 minutes long. And we're going to be premiering it in person at Main Street Landing a little over a month from now, on Thursday, April 21st at 7:00 p.m. You can reserve tickets for that at lakechamplainfilm.com. We just put the link up today. Again, you all are some of the very first people to see any of this material. So the tickets just went live. They're, if you're interested, you know, feel free to reserve them. And we're on Instagram as well, Lake Champlain Film. Yeah.
So I think now we're going to turn it back to Lauren, maybe to field questions if there are any, and continue the conversation. But thank you all so much for giving us a chance to talk about this adventure. And for you long trail hikers, I hope you consider this to be your next through adventure.
Awesome. Thank you, Jordan and Duane, so much. We really enjoyed that. Everyone, it can be hard for them to get feedback being in the room that they're in and you all at home on the couch. So we've come to a new idea where if you go in the chat and like put in a bunch of exclamation points or use that little clap symbol if that's there, so that we can do a virtual applause from the comfort of our own homes. So thanks a bunch, Jordan and Duane, for that. We do have some questions, folks. If you have any lingering things from the presentation or you want to know more about their experience, please put those in the Q&A. We got a couple minutes to tackle that. So Jordan, I can share with you what we have right now, and we'll keep on seeing what comes in.
Yeah, send them along.
Great. First thing, your music was really enjoyed. And folks are wondering where kind of the soundtrack and music came from.
Awesome. That's great to hear. That music is made actually by Jordan's upstairs neighbor, Adam Walensky, a local Burlington musician here. He's made all this original music custom for the film. We're working with him. This is, I actually forgot to mention that these are work in progress clips. We actually haven't quite finished with the film. We got about a little over a month before the premiere, but so we're wrapping it up, putting the final touches on the music. But yeah, Adam Walensky, fantastic guitarist, pedal steel guitar is that sound.
Cool. Thanks, Duane. Maybe we can find him and share that. Another question folks have is, given all your interviews that you did with people and the folks you met along the way, did you learn anything that surprised you or changed your perspective on the lake and its basin?
That's a great question. I think for me, one of the most impactful quotes that came out of this experience was when Karen Fortin, a farmer we spoke to on the trip, told me that at one point her children came home to her and asked her the question, Mommy, why do people hate farmers? And it just spoke to what was happening in conversations around the lake that was talking largely about agriculture being a sort of a source of a lot of phosphorus ending up in the lake. But it, to me, it showed the importance of recognizing the difference between a system, maybe an agricultural system having room for improvement as opposed to an individual like a farmer. And it's important to recognize the difference between those things. And so that was sort of the biggest thing that sort of surprised me was that they'd had that experience.
Nice. Yeah, I think that's really astute that, you know, it's not that one individual is doing that. It's the whole thing that developed around what's happening there. That's really cool. We have another question from folks. What was the scariest part of the trip? You're out on the lake for you know, 2 weeks, and you said it's pretty rough. It can be choppy. Where did you find your fear elevated there?
For me, it was actually a morning that we set off. I met Jordan at the mouth of the Winooski River, actually the morning after we conducted that interview. And we met at the boat launch. I think that's Colchester. What's that called? The boat launch right into the river. And set out into the lake. And as soon as we came around that point, it was like glass in the river. And then as soon as we got into the lake, it was, you know, like 3-foot swells. And I quickly realized that dinghy was not equipped. I tightened my life jacket. And I was like, I gotta go, man. I gotta turn around. That was one point where we realized, it was the conditions changed faster than we could have imagined.
Yeah. And for me, it was one day that it was just me out on the lake. We weren't filming. It was a very windy day. It was very rainy, and it was the first time I came close to falling out of my boat, and yeah, that was pretty scary because I, you know, tried to practice rolling and everything before the trip, but it's still nerve-wracking. Again, I'm not, water is not my happy place necessarily, and so I did not want to fall in upside down.
I gotta ask, did you fall in at all, Jordan?
Well, you just have to wait and see.
Great, that's good. A couple other questions. How often did you resupply for food? How far apart were your campsites?
Yeah, so the goal of the Lake Champlain Paddlers Trail is to have a campsite every 8 miles. It's still in progress. And so there's a couple portions where campsites are a little bit further apart. And I think the longest I paddled in a day was maybe 15 miles. And it was funny because for the early part of the trip, I was doing some of those longer days. And then in the later part of the trip, I was doing shorter days and I thought it would be easy. But that's when I realized the impact that a strong headwind can have. And so doing 7 miles suddenly felt like 20. Yeah.
In terms of food resupply, I think you maybe once, right?
Yeah, I think one time. And this was a supported adventure for those supported adventurers out in the crowd who I know there might be some. Luckily, I had Duane to bring me some resupply throughout the trip.
Awesome. Thanks. This is kind of a loaded question from Teresa, but I'm going to ask it. Are you optimistic about the health of the lake?
I think so.
I'm definitely optimistic that there is work that can be done and that we should be doing it. So I don't know if it's, if there's a difference between optimism and hope, but I do have hope. It's kind of sobering to see that kind of bloom up close, but you know, meeting all of these people along the way who are actively working to, you know, make this place, have it, you know, create a brighter future for this place did give me hope.
Yeah, I think it's hard to have the experience we had and not leave hopeful because of the people that we talked to. Yeah.
I'm excited to see the film and see all the people you talked to and to learn and like gather that hopefulness from the film as well. That's awesome. Thanks, Teresa, for that. Someone's asking, did you use one kayak for the whole trip? What kind of kayak? And then in terms of like gear or equipment, you know, is there anything specific you'd recommend for paddling on Lake Champlain?
Yeah, awesome question. It was a Wilderness Systems Tempest 130. I think that's like 13 feet long. I got it on Craigslist. I still have it actually. And yeah, just the one boat. And then in terms of gear, you really need a PFD. I don't think you should be out on Lake Champlain without one. You also need a bilge pump to pump out your boat in case you get water in it. You should have a radio, a marine radio, so that you can call the Coast Guard if you need to, or just converse with other people. Having an extra paddle is important too, in case you do flip, if your paddle floats away, your kayak's not much use doing the doggy paddle thing.
But it's a sea kayak is a short answer, right? We saw pictures, but the very long kind of straight line kind of kayak.
Great. Wonderful. And then kind of related, you know, for people to one of those poll questions was, what's the factor that limits? Is it the, you know, getting out with people, what could people use? So what was the name again of the group that you paddled with in the beginning there?
Yeah, there's a group called the Lake Champlain Kayakers Club, who is always looking for new people to join up and go on adventures. They'll take anybody of any experience level. And I'd also point folks towards the Lake Champlain Sailing Community Sailing Center also does really affordable rentals of kayaks on the Burlington waterfront. I know the Maritime Museum runs some youth programs for kayaking, intro to kayaking adventures, which are really good too. So those are some examples of sort of ways to get out there.
Awesome. Thanks. We got just a couple more questions that we can answer for folks. What kind of wildlife and birds did you see along the way? Was there a lot of that out there?
Yeah, in the south part of the lake, it's a lot of wetlands around the shoreline. So you see a lot of great blue herons. We did see some hawks. We saw a couple bald eagles. So it's definitely a rich area for birds. If we have any birders in the crowd, a good place to go. In terms of terrestrial animals, I didn't see a ton just because I wasn't on land as much. But the birds and I was startled almost to the point of flipping over my kayak multiple times when fish would jump out of the water. And there was one night sitting near Ticonderoga that it was like a symphony of fish popping out of the water all night long. And that was a really cool experience.
Cool. That's awesome. Duane, you mentioned the underwater film scenes, how you felt that was really important, you know, in the eventual film that people can go see. Did you include those underwater film scenes? And have you thought about another film idea of lots of underwater film scenes?
It's a great question. Yeah. You know, there is, of course, a great community of people, you know, diving and studying the shipwrecks, the great many shipwrecks that are in Lake Champlain. And early on, I thought that would be an interesting part of the story to try to tell. Unfortunately, we didn't end up doing any diving for this film. Would have loved to. The underwater stuff that we shot for this is mostly limited to me, you know, in a PFD, you know, in the water, filming Jordan passing by, some, you know, from underneath, some from, you know, when he's doing the pulling invasive species, I'm in there with, you know, underneath the water chestnuts themselves. So I'd love to do more underwater photography and tell more of the story of the lake from beneath the surface.
Awesome. Thanks. And then, you know, it was really great to hear your goals, to have that laid out. I really enjoyed that. After mentioning, you know, getting youth involved and how you grew up right on the lake, but you didn't have, you know, the experience that maybe you just had on your trip. someone's asking, you know, should they be informing their local K-8 school about your film? Are you canvassing local schools? Is there something that the crowd could do to help get that message out there, I guess?
Yeah, so after our premiere, we're going to have a finished product to be able to send directly to any schools in the region if they want to put on a screening of their own. As you know, we have availability to put on screenings at local schools. And to be honest with you, we are open to being connected with as many educators and teachers who are interested in incorporating this into their classroom. And so please feel free to find us on Instagram and send us a direct message. You can go to our website, which I know Lauren will be sending out the link to again when he follows up for this webinar. But yeah, we want to get this in front of as many people and students in the basin as possible. And so, Ted.
I'll add to that's kind of like our main priority is getting this in front of youth, I think. We'll also be creating a classroom guide. I'm really kind of imagining this as a film for the classroom and would love for it to be used as a resource to inspire, you know, the next generation to get out there and kind of get familiar with this place. Our website, lakechamplainfilm.com. We're also lakechamplainfilm@gmail.com. If you'd like to email us, we will be looking, you know, to connect with as many educators as possible.
Awesome. Thank you, Duane and Jordan. Yeah, we'll, at the end of this, we'll send out a follow-up to everybody and you'll get a whole bunch of ways to contact Duane and Jordan to see more. One last question and then we'll say our goodbyes. Haley is asking if there were any champ sightings.
You'll just have to wait and see.
Beautiful. Thank you, Haley, for the wonderful, wonderful send-out question. So everyone, I'd like to thank you all again for coming in tonight and hearing Duane and Jordan about their adventure, getting some excitement for their film. April 21st, right, at Main Street Landing.
That's right.
We'll send that all out to everybody. You can check that out. Last thing I'd like to say is when you click out of this webinar, you'll see a survey pop up. We'd love for you to complete that. It helps Green Mountain Club improve the programming that we deliver. And you can say all of your congratulations to Duane and Jordan on their wonderful film and presentation tonight in that survey as well. Duane, Jordan, any last words to leave folks with here before we say goodnight?
Thank you for being here. We hope to see you at the premiere next month.
Yeah, don't forget to get your tickets.
Good night, everyone.
Thank you.